So I'm Professor Dongling Ma, holder of Canada Research Chair, and today I'm very pleased to give this keynote speech on nanohybrids for energy, environmental, and biomedical applications. Okay, so my group has been interested in developing different functional nanoscale materials for energy, environmental, and biomedical applications. And initially, we worked with a single component in nanomaterials, such as quantum dots, nanoparticle catalyst, and plasmonic nanostructures of different shapes. For the past 10 years, we have shifted our research focus, and now we are more interested in combining different nanocomponents into nanohybrids. We have two good reasons for that. The first reason is to enhance performance or properties for nanohybrids, and which can be used for solar cells and photocatalysis. The second reason, even better, to get multiple functionalities. For example, in this work, we show we combine luminescent nanoshells with magnetic cores to get multifunctional nanoparticles for biomedical applications. We have shifted our research focus on materials, but our targeted applications haven't changed. The first most application is energy. With no doubt, we all believe that we human can't need more energy. This energy demands is ever increasing. It's kind of related with economic growth and technology development, and you can see the increase of global energy. Okay, so here you can see with the increase of energy consumption with the technology development, especially around 1950. But this is not only factor, the increase of population also contributed to increase energy demand. You can see the population increase from 1820 to 2019 dramatically, especially after 1950. So it's also contributed to energy increase. As a result, the world needs twice as much energy in 2040 as it produces today if we can't improve energy efficiency. Then it sounds simple. Okay, let's increase our capacity to make more efficient energy use or increase the energy production. But the story is not that simple. We are facing a great dilemma. With increasing energy production, there is a greenhouse gas emission, climate change, and environmental pollution. The problem is related with the current structure of energy mix. If you look at the global energy consumption in 2019, you can see over 90% of energy we consume come from oil, coal, and natural gas. Related with the use of these energy resources, there is great CO2 emission. So you can see here, the CO2 emission related with the use of these three energy resources account for over 90% of CO2 emission. And the CO2 emission is ever increasing with increasing energy consumption. So the good solution will be to make more energy, but clean energy, by using global renewable energy resources. In this case, we can increase energy production, but without a negative environmental impact. So here I list some renewable energy resources like biomass, solar, water, geothermal, and wind. Among them, solar energy is most attractive. It stresses at energy level of 120,000 terawatts. If we can make a good use of this energy, we should be able to meet our energy demands without a negative environmental effect. Especially for solar energy, it reaches the Earth per hour at a higher level than the world energy use for the year. There are different ways to use solar energy. For example, solar energy can be transformed to electricity, to thermal energy, or to chemical energy, like by water splitting to get hydrogen, which is clean fuel, or CO2 reduction to get CO, which is an important component of a syngas. And even better, solar energy can be used to photocatalytically degrade environments pollution, which can lead to better environments. So for these later two technologies, photocatalysis can help to achieve the goal of clean fuel generation and better environments. So the overall picture sounds beautiful, but unfortunately, most of these techniques are not very efficient at this moment. So can we make more efficient solar photo processes? Let's look at the basic operation principle of photocatalysis. So basically, semiconductor can absorb solar energy, get excited to generate electrons and holes. Electrons can be used for reduction and holes can be used for oxidation. Of course, those excited electrons, holes, they can also recombine. In this case, they will not contribute to photocatalysis process. So as I said, most of technologies are still not very efficient, like photocatalysis. There are major limitations for the poor efficiency. The first one is limited light absorption. The second one is serious charge carrier recombination. So to make these solar photo processes more efficient, it's important to increase light absorption. If you look at the solar spectrum, it covers a very broad range. But for most photocatalytic systems, they don't really use photons in near infrared range. And even for the longer wavelength part in the visible, they are not lead to efficient photocatalysis. So it's very important to design photocatalyst which has broad photo response and also can lead to efficient photocatalysis at longer wavelengths. Of course, also important to have efficient electron hole generation and has largely suppressed the charge carrier recombination and have efficient surface reactions. So there are several strategies which can help to achieve more efficient solar photo processes. For example, by forming heterojunctions, doing doping, defect engineering, and also coupling semiconductor materials with plasmonic nanoparticles. In today's talk, I will mainly focus on heterojunction formation. So the first part of my talk will be nanohybrids for energy and environmental applications. So we have combined plasmonic materials with the second semiconductor materials to make nanohybrids for broadband photocatalysis. Plasmonic nanomaterials, they can contribute to photocatalysis by absorbing photons to generate electrons holes. We call them hot electrons holes, and they can be used for photocatalysis. They can also enhance semiconductor absorption by light scattering effect and near field effect. In this way, they also contribute to photocatalysis. So we have combined plasmonic materials with the semiconductors in different configurations. So here I show some of our work. In all these configurations, we observed a large increase of photocatalytic activity. But there is a question about long-term sustainability, because in these plasmonic materials, expensive metals are used. So for this reason, we started to look into another material towards making metal-free photocatalyst, which can absorb a lot of photons and have efficient photocatalysis, but metal-free. So we started to look into black phosphorus, which is a very interesting material. Unlike graphene that has a zero band gap, two-dimensional black phosphorus shows a direct band gap tunable from 0.3 to 2 electrowatts, depending on the number of layers. And it has a wide working spectral range from visible to near infrared, and also relatively high carrier, charge carrier mobility. All this predict that BP can be a very good photocatalyst. But BP has two problems. The first is that the synthesized yield, the scale up of BP synthesis. And the second problem is stability because it's easily react with moisture and oxygen to get oxidized. So this excellent student Qin Zheng made effort to address these two problems. He invented NMPS assisted synthesis of BP nanosheets method, and this is patent pending. So basically that we use NMP to insert these nanocrystals inside BP nanosheets to weaken the interaction BP nanosheet. As a result, the BP can be easily exfoliated. The advantage of this NMPS assisted synthesis is very obvious. The synthesized yield is largely enhanced to 75% with respect to normally reported 15 to 30%. Energy requirement is much lower, 70 watts for 2 hours. Process duration is much shorter, 2 hours, with respect to normally reported 8 to 20 hours. And the number of atomic layers is about 6, and over 90% of abatement nanosheets have thickness less than 10 nanometer, and also BP nanosheets, they show quite good colloidal stability, very stable, and no aggregation for longer than 4 weeks during the storage in a good solvent. But how about the chemical stability? As I mentioned, BP can be easily oxidized. To address this problem, we stack BP with another 2D material, cesium-4, to make a 2D on 2D nanohybrids. So here shows the EDX mapping of cesium-4, and here shows BP and superimposed image. And you can see BP and the cesium-4, they stack with each other. As a result, BP become more stable based on XPS measurement. So here, this peak is related with oxidized BP. You can see that the peak is much stronger than that in the hybrid. This is for pure BP. So under the same conditions, so indicate BP stability largely enhanced with this 2D on 2D approach. So we choose the cesium-4 to stack with the BP. We have two purposes. One is for enhancing stability for the BP. The other is to get a good photocatalytic activity because cesium-4 is known to be a very promising visible driven photocatalyst. So we stack them together to make broadband nanohybrids, nanohybrids photocatalyst. So here shows the theoretical calculations for BP nanosheets of different layers, a different number of layers. You can see the absorption can be tuned and they show broad photon absorption. As expected, once the BP coupled with the cesium-4, the absorption at the longer wavelengths of the photocatalyst is largely enhanced. This contributes to photocatalysis. Once the light is on, photocatalytic activity is enhanced. So we use longer than 420 nanometer visible light for excitation, for solar water splitting to get hydrogen. We can see for 3% BP on cesium-4, the activity is significantly high as compared to pure cesium-4 and pure BP. It's not difficult to understand if you look at this mechanism. So 3% BP cesium-4, cesium-4 is a major part. With this excitation, mainly cesium-4 will be excited to get electrons holes, and the electrons can be injected into the conduction band edge of BP. And this level was confirmed by our experimental measurements. So the charge recombination will be largely suppressed, and the increased charge separation contributed to photocatalytic behavior. This charge transfer from cesium-4 to BP is also confirmed by measuring photoluminescence of cesium-4. You can see the large quenching in the hybrids due to charge transfer from cesium-4 to BP. And also we observed a lifetime shortening due to the charge transfer. So this mechanism is confirmed. But how about longer wavelength photocatalytic activity? Remember, we combine BP with the cesium-4. We would like to get longer wavelength photoactivity. So with this excitation, cesium-4 will not be excited. Only BP will be excited. Again, we observed a large increase of photocatalytic hydrogen generation as compared to PUBP and PC34. So nanohybrids is way more active. At the first sight, when you look at this figure, you will be confused. How come this happens? BP will be excited, but electrons holes can't be separated because the energy level look like doesn't allow this to happen. So what we think happening here is that at the interface between BP and the C34, there's forming of the bond between BP and the C34, which serve as interfacial states. This has been confirmed by our XPS measurements, but it would be good to do transient absorption spectroscopy to further confirm that, and we hope we will be able to find a collaborator to do that part of work. So I have given you one example showing that by forming heterojunction, we can get broadband photocatalyst with a 2D on 2D approach. But here, I just would like to give you one quick slide to show homojunction also helps with photon absorption and photocatalytic activities. So in this case, we work with the metal organic framework nanostacks. So in this structure, we have two nanoplates. One is smaller, one is larger morph nanoplates. They have slightly different structures. We stack them together to get a homojunction. And here shows the TM 3D structure construction. And with this 2D on 2D stacking, we can get increased absorption, charge separation improved, photocatalytic activity is also enhanced. So we use CO2 reduction as a model reduction. So here as a model reaction. So here you can see for the nanostack, the activity is largely enhanced as compared to the single plate. And even better, the selectivity for CO is close to 100%. So the nanohybrids, these homojunction, show largely enhanced selectivity and activity. So usually for a metal organic framework, the activity isn't very high. So this work is really promising, and we hope we will be able to further develop more efficient homojunction, more of networks for photocatalysis. So with that, I can finish the first part and shift to the second part, nanohybrids for biomedical applications. So here shows global challenges facing humanity. I think you all agree health issues are important. Actually, it's listed as the top 10 global challenges. Especially now we are in the global pandemic. We know it's very important to find an efficient way to do highly sensitive early disease detection, effective treatment, and also appropriate monitoring after the treatments. Due to time limitation, I will not enter into details, but I would like to pass you a brief message. Combining of photoluminescent and magnetic nanocomponents into a multifunctional nanoarchitecture is highly promising for solving health issues. So here, just a brief introduction, superparamagnetic nanoparticles. Those nanoparticles, they show very high magnetic moments, just as ferromagnetic materials, but they show zero remnant magnetic moments as paramagnetic materials. So this interesting combination allows them to be easily confined by magnetic force, means they can rapidly respond to the presence of magnetic field, but also they can be easily re-separated, so redispersed into solution. So superparamagnetic nanoparticles have fundamental applications in biomedical fields like hypothermia, drug delivery, magnetic resonance imaging, and separation, collection, and labeling, and for efficient, highly sensitive, trace amount of detection of various bacteria, so on and so forth. For photoluminescence, quantum dots are possibly most promising. Quantum dots are semiconductor nanocrystals. By tuning sizes, they can give emission different colors and with high emission intensity as compared to the traditional dye molecules. So in our case, we are interested to work with near infrared quantum dots. These quantum dots can be excited by near infrared light and also can emit in the near infrared light. As a result, they can show deep tissue imaging capability. And we combine these near infrared quantum dots with super paramagnetic nanoparticles to make multifunctional nanoparticles. So we can combine them different way, like in this case, self-assemble to have multiple magnetic particles, quantum dots inside a single nano architecture. And in this case, we have a mesoporous framework, and then we fill them with magnetic particles and quantum dots. These also multifunctional nanoparticles, but in this case, the photoluminescent part are not quantum dots, but an up-converting nanoshell, which can give photoluminescence in the near-infrared field. And here is a single super paramagnetic core. So depending on the combination, they can have different applications. Here I will just give one example about the self-assembled quantum dots and magnetic particles. First, about quantum dots, we used a cost-effective method, a microwave approach, to synthesize them. We coat lead sulfide with a thin shell of cadmium sulfide to get high-quality quantum dots dispersed in oil phase. And then again, we use microwave approach to coat the second layer zinc sulfide. At the same time, we replace the initially long ligands with hydrophilic ligands, which allow these quantum dots well dispersed in water phase in buffers. These Kaushal-Shell quantum dots show very good performance. They give high intensity emission in the near infrared range, allows tracking of quantum dots distribution in mice, and also very stable, like 30 months. Their emission basically doesn't change. This was image from near infrared camera, and also they allow the deep tissue imaging. Here we use either chicken or pork tissue, and we put quantum dots in microfluid channel to detect the imaging signal. We detect quantum dots emitted in the different wavelengths. We found quantum dot emitting in the second biological window can give deepest penetration. So we mainly use these quantum dots for the construction of multifunctional nanoplatforms. So the work was done by this excellent student and Fan Yang. So basically, he synthesized quantum dots few nanometer, and iron oxide quantum dots slightly larger size, about 10 nanometer in diameter. Then using self-assembled approach, he can put quantum dots and iron oxide particles into the single particles about 60 nanometers in diameter. And in each single nanoparticle, in each single particle, not a nano. So here, basically, you can see many magnetic particles and many quantum dots. They can be easily identified because they have different lattice image fringes and also different sizes. Based on EDAX mapping, you can see the uniformly distributed in this single architecture. So here, mainly show magnetic components, and here shows quantum dots components. So here, I'd like to show the deep tissue imaging capability of these multifunctional particles. We use this setup, use an 800 nanometer laser, and the QYT contains multifunctional particles. Here, put the tissue, and the near infrared camera will pick up, collect emitted photons. Then you can see that with the use of quantum dots emitting in the second biological window, we can get signals even up to about 12 millimeter. This is very difficult to achieve with traditional dye molecules. And also with the presence of magnetic components, these multifunctional nanoparticles can be used for magnetic resonance imaging. So it means these multifunctional particles can realize bimodal imaging for magnetic part. I didn't show, but if you are interested, you can easily find these images in our published paper. Here, I would like to demonstrate another functionality of these nano architectures, dual-mode thermal treatment. So what we did here is that in this park tissue, we inject our multifunctional nanoparticles and here for the control part, there's no particles. Then we place this zampon here. We can shed the laser or we can use a magnetic field to heat it up. So as I said, the laser can cause the emission of multifunctional particles, but also can cause a quantum dot to release the heat. Then we measure temperature increase under laser and the magnetic field or under the beam both. You can see with the laser temperature increase for this part and magnetic field also temperature increase larger. And when we put both magnetic field and the laser excitation, the temperature is increased much more. But as a clear contrast from the control part, the part without our multifunctional nanoparticles, basically there's no temperature change. So here it shows that with our dual model heating treatment, the temperature can largely increase, indicating high potential for these particles to be used as a dual mode thermal treatment agent. We know for magnetic hypothermia therapy usually requires high concentration of ion nanoparticles, then the concentration used for magnetic resonance imaging. But in our case, the thermal energy transfer efficiency can be amplified sevenfold compared with magnetic heating alone. So this allows us to use tiny amount of ion oxide particles to get both good MR imaging and also sufficient heating effect. And also for photothermal therapy, there are some other advantages like easy operation, non-invasiveness, high specificity, and a reasonable penetration. So the combination of magnetic and photoluminescent quantum dots really have a high potential for many biomedical applications. We hope we will be soon able to explore more for these multifunction nanoparticles. So with that, I think I can go to the conclusions. Hybrid can help improve properties and performance and lead to multifunctions. Rational design of nanocomponent structures are very important for taking good advantage of respective benefit. If we want to be metal-free, black phosphorus has a high potential in broadband photocatalysis, and a combination of luminescent and superparamagnetic nanoparticles lead to various biomedical applications like deep tissue imaging, magnetic confinement. I didn't show today. Magnetic resonance imaging, photothermal treatment, drug delivery. I didn't show, but you can easily check our publications. So with that, I would like to thank my collaborators, including external collaborators and also internal collaborators. Also, I would like to thank students who directly contributed to the work I presented today. And also would like to thank financial agent at, from Canada federal government and Quebec provincial government. With that, I can finish my talk. And if you have questions, you can easily reach me at this email address. Thank you very much for your participation and for your interest.